Good morning, Experience Church, and happy Easter Sunday to all of our friends and our families joining us online. We're so glad we get to spend our morning with you.
Yeah, and if this is your first time with us, we are super glad that you're here, and we would love to learn how to better serve you. So we created a link for you in the description below where we have a digital connection card that you can fill out with as much or as little information as you'd like, and you'll be able to send it to us.
That's right. And maybe you don't want to fill out a digital connection card, but you have a prayer request. Well, you're in luck because we are a praying church and we love to pray. And so you can just text the word pray to the number on the screen. That's 415-289-9995. And our team is going to get back to you to pray with you, whether by text or by phone call. During our worship experience, if you have any questions at all about how to find information, our moderators are in the chat. They're in the comments section. So you can ask your questions there and we'd be able to point you in the right direction.
Yes, so let's go ahead and get our hearts ready for worship because we have a reason to celebrate because Jesus is risen.
The life he gave, your body was broken, he loved poured out, you bled and you died for me there on the cross, you breathed your last. when death had claimed its victory. The King of love had given up his life. The darkest day in history.
Dear church, we're severely underselling Jesus' work on the cross and the miracle of the resurrection. We love to celebrate his birth and his ministry here on earth, but whenever it comes to his death and when all of the breath was gone from his chest and he was left lying motionless as his mother wept, we spend less time on this text and fail to realize what his resurrection actually meant and what it signifies for us today, for you right now. Through his resurrection, we know that life is stronger than death, love is stronger than hatred, hope is greater than despair, and for the promise of eternal life is available to those who dare to cast away their burdens and cares and submit themselves to the one whom none can compare. The resurrection fully renewed the relationship between you and your Creator, not because of anything that we had done, but all by the death of his Son. Because if Jesus hadn't died in our place, we could never enter his eternal gates or ever look upon his holy face or experience the sweetest taste of his love. Man could never fulfill the debt of sin, and God could not relate to fallen men. So Jesus had to pay the price that we couldn't. He had to live the life that we wouldn't. And upon that wooden cross, he died when he shouldn't. You see, we belonged on that cross, not him. We should have hung from that cross, not him. We deserve to be beaten and bruised, but not him. And that is why the cross is so important. That is why Easter should not be ignored, because whenever that stone rolled away, whenever Jesus walked out of that grave, he showed us that we are loved and no longer enslaved, and that all of our sins have been weighed and placed upon that cross. So this Easter, let's remember the love that we've been given and not go through the motions to fulfill some annual tradition, but actively celebrate that Jesus, he's risen, and the reality that we've been forgiven. Because what was meant for death brought life.
Fill the light. That's right. Today we celebrate Easter. And guys, what's Easter really all about anyway?
It's about Jesus and his love for us.
Yeah.
Yeah. He even died on the cross so we could be forgiven.
And he rose from the dead.
That's right. And it's that love that we all get to celebrate today because it's available for all of us.
That's right. And we love to celebrate. What's everybody's favorite Easter candy?
Mine's the Reese's Bunnies.
Mm. Oh, I love sweet tart jelly beans.
Cotton candy.
Those little puffy cottontails. I like the caramel Cadbury eggs.
The Peeps.
Peeps.
Jack Jones all about those Peeps. That's right. Today we celebrate the blood-stained cross, the empty tomb, and the risen Savior. Our talk today is about the truest thing about you. And the scripture that we're going to read today is one that you may know. Maybe you've seen it on a t-shirt, a bumper sticker, or maybe even a meme. Let's read it.
Yes, it's John 3:16. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, that have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him."
Wow. Let's bow our heads and pray this morning. Father, we thank you so much for your love for us. Love so big that it cost you your own Son. We pray today that we would experience that love, we would trust that love, and we would believe in that love. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I'm not really a crier, so when I do, it's usually a good one. And I'll never forget the first time that I actually cried in public. I was at this interesting kind of place in my life where I was figuring out my faith and was invited to like this spiritual retreat. And to be quite honest, at the time, I was really struggling in my faith. I was frustrated. I was embarrassed. I felt like these patterns and behaviors that I was wanting to break and change weren't breaking very easily and felt like I was behind. And I had all this pent-up emotion running through me. And I'll never forget going out on that Friday night and hearing about the love of God. And God's love that night went from my mind to my heart. It went from thought and concept to experience. And I'll never forget feeling the love of God right where I was. And I just started crying. And it became like a snowball effect avalanche. I straight up like dirty cried. You know what I mean? The people around me were not moved to tears. They were moved to fear. They're like, what is happening to this guy? And in the midst of all those tears, I had no idea how much pent up anger and frustration and rejection and fear and just feeling like such a failure. All of that was rising up. And while I'm receiving God's love, I realize that all of that is okay because I'm still loved. That's right. A.W. Tozer said that the most important thing about us is the first thought that comes into our mind when we think about God. That night, my first thought became love. God is love. What's your first thought? Is God close or is he distant? Is he out of touch or is he in touch and deeply personal? Is he a God that's approachable and warm and welcoming, or is he cold and stiff? What do you think about when you think about God? I know everything changed for me that night because I began to see God as love. And many of us, we have struggled, or we perhaps will struggle with this religious thought of God being this condemning, shaming, rule-giving enforcer. And what Jesus did, what we read about in John chapter 3, is that he came to actually show people what God was like. He came to set the record straight. And here's the really good news. God is really good. He's a loving father that pursues relationship with his kids. He doesn't want anything from us. He just wants us. He's a loving father that wants us. And so this religious image of a condemning God couldn't be more wrong. It's absolute fake news. It's made up of lies. Here's the truth. You are so loved. You are so loved. You are loved way more than you think you are. Ephesians chapter 3 says, the astonishing love of Christ. How deeply intimate and far-reaching is his love. How enduring and inclusive. Endless love beyond measurement that transcends our understanding. This extravagant love pours into you until you are filled to overflowing. That's the kind of love that God gives, an overflowing love. And did you know that there's actually nothing you can do to change that? Whether you believe it or not, you're loved. Whether you feel it or not, you're loved. Whether you welcome it with open arms or whether you reject it or run from it, you are loved. And God's love for you is the truest thing about you. Let me explain. See, the truest thing about you is not fame. It's not fortune. It's not family name or net worth. It's not your resume or your last performance review. It's not even your age or your gender or your race. You can change almost everything about yourself, but you can't change that you are loved. That doesn't change. Romans chapter 8 says, I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, angels or demons, fears for today or worries about tomorrow, all of us have them right now, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. So there are two things that you have to believe these things in order for love to be, to go from a concept into an experience and a life. The first is this: you are loved as you are. As you are right now, with your doubts and your fears and your failures and your frustrations, with your emotions, with your isolation, your loneliness, with your maybe financial debt or just lost it. As you are loved. 1 John 3:1 says this, look with wonder at the depth of the Father's marvelous love that he has lavished on us. He has called us and made us his very own beloved children. See, he calls us to come as we are. Right where we're at. As you are right now, you are love. Listen to this story about someone that came as they were to God's love.
My name is Lucia, and I wanted to share with you what God has done in my life. I didn't grow up in church, and I used to think that Jesus was a fairy tale that people used to tell their kids about. And I believed that if I could control everything and everyone around me, I would have peace in my life. So I had a really hard time maintaining friendships and relationships with people. When I went off to college, somehow, all of my friends were believers, and I wasn't really interested in getting to know God, but I knew that they had this whole entire part of their lives and their experiences that I was missing out on, and I wanted to understand my friends better. So I went to church. I had been out all night partying, and I made it there just in time for worship. Now, at this time in my life, music and performing were my entire world. And that's where God met me. I was sitting there in worship, experiencing music, and in that moment, I knew God was real. And I wish I had the words to describe to you what it's like to meet God for the first time, but I knew that he loved me unconditionally as I was. God has brought so much peace into my life. I love others and I love myself more than I ever thought I could. And not having to be in control of everything and trusting God has made me feel so free.
Wow, isn't that story so encouraging? Number two, this is what you just gotta believe. Number two is that you are loved right where you are. Right where you are. You think, man, I need to get my stuff together. I need to clean up my mess. Can I tell you can't get your stuff together? none of us can, that actually begins to happen once we begin to trust and receive God's love for us. And I even look at my life now, I'm certainly not where I want to be, but thank God I'm not where I used to be. And that's all because of God's love. He loves you right in the middle of a divorce. He loves you right in the middle of a bad, messy breakup, in job loss and in sickness. Wherever you are, whatever is going on in your life, He loves you right where you are. Not where you think you are, or where you think you should be, or could have been, or would have been. No, right where you are, wherever that is, He loves you right now, right where you are. Listen to this incredibly encouraging story about God's love meeting someone right where they are.
Growing up, I was the type of kid who was always asking questions. I remember asking myself questions like, what is life? What is the purpose of life? And how could I be happy? These were questions at a young age I didn't even know how to approach. And I found myself feeling purposeless. I found myself feeling lost and alone. Things only got worse as I went off to college, and for the first time, I was literally alone. I remember around this time, my dad had left my family, and just there was so much going on. But in the midst of my struggles, in the midst of depression, suicidal thoughts, uncertainty, and purposelessness, Jesus came into my life. He met me right where I was. He showered me with grace, He called me beloved, filled me with peace, and He gave me a purpose. He took what was broken and He made it whole. He took what was lost and He called it found. And to what was dead inside, He gave life. Because of what He did, I can sit here today and share with you how God had met me in my brokenness, in my doubt, and in my suffering. He met me right where I was.
Maybe the current crisis has you not feeling loved at all. It's got you feeling all kinds of things, but certainly not love. Maybe you feel anxious or alone. Maybe you feel heavy or stuck. Maybe you're feeling just unsettled, scared. Maybe even the grief and the sense of loss is beginning to become more and more real. Maybe you don't really even know what you're feeling. You just know that it's not normal and it doesn't feel good. I've had single friends tell me that this is the most single that I've ever felt. I've had parents tell me, I feel absolutely suffocated. I feel like I can't get away. I've got nowhere to go. I can't breathe. Those are very real feelings. And those are feelings that we need to invite God to meet us in the midst of. Here's an important truth that I want you to know. Whatever you are feeling right now, As real as it is, it doesn't change how God feels about you. That's right. You are treasured. You are cherished. You are favored. You are special. You are wanted. You are desired. You are so loved. That's you. You are loved. So what stands in the way of you receiving all of God's love for you? I'll tell you what stands in the way. A lot of us would think sin first, but I don't really think that's it. I think what stands in the way is religion. I think religion is enemy number one. A great theologian said that religion is even more cruel than sin. See, religion promises what it can't deliver. It promises happiness and fulfillment and freedom and independence. But what it actually gives is anxiety and emptiness and slavery to self. I heard someone recently say, a person wrapped up in themselves makes for a very small package. And see, religion is condemnation, it's performance, it's pressure and fear and control. It's empty and it's cold and there's no heart in it. Religion leads to behavior modification, not heart transformation. And can I tell you, here in the Bay Area, oh, we most certainly do have a religion. We have a belief system here. We believe in eating vegan, recycling and composting and doing yoga. We believe in walking our dogs and cleaning up after them every time. We love our technology and our apps, and we love being cutting edge and really ahead of everybody else. We love our parties and our festivals and our parades and Burning Man. We are a religion here in the Bay Area that ultimately worships image. It worships our image, the image that we do everything we can to create and produce and manufacture, all in order to be loved, to feel loved, to feel like we're enough. But can I tell you, none of those things make you feel that way. None of those things make you feel like you belong. None of those things give you meaning and purpose. And none of them are bad things, but they just won't do what we think they will. Only God's love can give you that meaning, purpose, and fulfillment. And this is why Jesus offers relationship. Religion offers rules. Big difference there. Religion is all about do's and don'ts. Jesus is all about loving you and watching you change and nurturing your growth from the inside out. Religion is not love. Religion is actually a horrible substitute. It cannot replace love. It's actually counterfeit love. It's love turned inward, where God's love, agape love, is love turned outward to others. And so relationship with Jesus is always based on his love for us, not us conjuring up some love, but us receiving his love that then leads to us living our best life. Listen to this verse, 1 John chapter 4, verse 18. It says this: there is no fear in love, because perfect love casts out all fear. Can you imagine a life without fear, living fearless? How much has fear taken from you, robbed from you? How much has it caused you to settle for far less than what God has for you in this life? See, that's what fear does. And the only way we overcome fear is by receiving God's love. See, love is the most powerful force on planet Earth. His love forgives us and shapes us and changes us and fills us with the fresh air of heaven and causes us to grow up to become who we were born to be, who we were put here on earth to become. Only love can do that. See, love brings out the best in us, our talents and our passions and our creativity. Love brings out the very best on the inside of us, ultimately for others. And religion's completely different. Religion just says, you know, just be a good person and stay out of trouble. Don't get caught. Did Jesus really die for you to live like that? Did he die for you to play it safe, for you to play not to lose, for you to live this safe, insulated, selfish life that doesn't help anybody? Because the life that we get as we follow Jesus and receive his love is completely different. It's a love that's outward towards others. Mother Teresa said it like this: do small things with great love. It's the little things. And I think right now in this midst of this crisis, we're all learning. It's the little things. It's the simple things. It's the hellos and the smiles and the text messages and sending gifts to people's houses and the drive-by waves. It's all the little things. It's these small acts of kindness with great love. This is the life that we begin to live. The Holy Spirit within us draws us to see the needs of other people, and we want to give our life away to others. This is the life of love. And so I want to pray for all of us this morning. I want us to receive that same type of experience of love that I had that changed everything for me. I believe that's available to all of us. If you would just bow your head and close your eyes. I want to pray for you this morning. Oh, Holy Spirit, would you come? Would you come right now, wherever we are, watching, listening, opening our hearts? Would you fill us with the Father's love? Would you let us feel how you feel about us? Would you take away all shame and all guilt and all fear? And would you cause us to live a life of love? In Jesus' name, amen. That's awesome. I hope you had an experience with God's love. I want to talk to all those people watching today that maybe you haven't given your life to Jesus yet. You haven't trusted in his love. Or maybe you haven't done it in a long time. You've wandered or walked away. And this is your day. This is your time, your opportunity to get your heart realigned and to come close to God again. If you want to make that decision, the best decision that any of us can make in our lives is to trust him and to get close to him. If that's you, just put your hand on your heart right now. And you can just whisper this simple prayer with me. Just say, Jesus, I need you. I want you. I believe in your love. I trust your love. I surrender to your love. Forgive me. Change me. Make me new. Help me follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for your courage and your faith in praying that prayer. I believe that God answers that prayer. And that you have a new life waiting on you. And we would love to help you walk into that new life. If you made a decision for Jesus today, there's a link provided in the comments here. We'd love to hear from you and give you some resources. And probably the greatest resource we can give you is this community group that we do called Alpha. And Alpha is done all over the world. And it's normally a dinner and drink, a film and a conversation. And right now we're going to be doing it virtual because of our current crisis. And so this coming Wednesday, we will be watching a film together and then jumping on Zoom and breaking out into different rooms for this beautifully rich discussion about life's biggest questions. Is there more to life than this? And who is Jesus? And how do I have faith? And these are all the things that we're going to be talking about in very safe, small groups where all of your beliefs are heard and you're listened to and you're able to go on a journey. You're able to ask questions. And we've seen this helps so many people figure out their faith. So we'd love for you to be a part of it. You can see all of the details online. Now here's something that I'm really excited about this morning, church. Is we're gonna receive our offering right now. So go ahead and get out what you're gonna give. I've got some really good news about how God's using our generosity. As a church, you know that you can give online and by text. You'll see that here on the screen. And you know that one of our values as a church is to be generous, is to become generous like Jesus. And this week we got some really good news. We just built our second well. That's right. Last week in the nation of Haiti, we built our second well as a church. We wanted to go there and build it ourselves last summer, but because of civil unrest, we were not allowed into the country. And so our ministry partners, Living Water International, their team and their staff built the well with our funds this past week. And I want to give you a little bit of the story. We built our well in Nan Mili, Haiti. And we are now serving 270 residents in this village. People in this village were walking 2 hours to get water, which was heavy and exhausting. It often kept many children from school, and they were taught sanitation and hygiene classes so that they can actually store the water and handle the water in a very safe way. And at the opening of our well, the Living Water staff was able to share the gospel with the entire village, which is absolutely awesome. And so I want to thank you so much. Your bottles and your cans that we bring to church and we smash and we recycle and then give that money to Living Water. That cans and bottles, that waste, so to speak, is now turned into safe, clean drinking water. And so your giving, your generosity is making a difference. It's saving lives and it's improving lives. Thank you so much for your generosity. Second, just so blown away. So much joy, big smile on my face. Your giving is absolutely tremendous. Last week, our benevolence fund that is created to help people in our church that are in need more than doubled last week in giving. So many of you have said, I'm going to give every week. I'm going to give over and beyond what I normally give to help those among us in our church family that are in need. So if you need financial assistance, please email us. info@exp.church. We want to serve you in every way that we can. And if you would like to give above your normal giving, you can use the code benevolence online or put benevolence in your text message as you give, and those funds will be designated. We're believing that we're going to be a church like the early church in the book of Acts, that there would be no needy among us, that God would use us to meet the needs of everybody in our community. So thankful for all that God's doing with our generosity. Now, I've asked our founding pastor, my pastor, Mark Smallcomb, a man of just such inspiring faith, to pray over our giving and to pray for provision for all of us and the people that are close to us during this time.
I guess you're wondering what's going to happen with your job, the economy, your finances, your ability to make the rent, or even make it through this time of global pandemic and fear. But time and time again, throughout the Bible, no matter what God's people faced, God always had provided enough for their situation, and not only to survive, but to thrive. What we're all facing now is an incredible opportunity to trust God for real, to have faith in His provision. And I have faith that His word will come through for you. And this is what it says: and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Let's pray. Lord God, you can pour on the blessings in such a way, even in our darkest moments, that we will have enough for ourselves, but an overflow to give out, to minister to others. We thank you. We have faith for your provision in this time, and we ask for an extended blessing on each person in Jesus' name.
Wow, that's our song. EXP Worship, you guys are just crushing it.
Yeah.
I love that song. So good. And thank you to everyone else who was a part of our online experience. I've been deeply encouraged, and this has got to be one of my favorite Easters so far.
We have a lot of stuff that's happening during the week, and we'd love for you to be a part of what God is doing through the church. So we're hosting daily prayer meetings at noon. And you can just come in and join us. You don't even have to pray. You can call in and just listen and observe. We're sad to say that this is the end of our online worship experience. But head on over to our church's Instagram, where Pastor Mark and Amanda will be hosting a live Q&A.
Well, we loved spending our Sunday with you, and we're so glad we got to enjoy Easter 2020 with everyone online. We hope that our online experience filled your heart with hope. Happy Easter. We'll see you guys next time.